So we'll continue our discussion on non-collisive oligopoly model also in this session. So if you remember in the last class, we discussed about the Carnot models, and Carnot models typically a duopoly market situation where the basic characteristic is that it operates in zero cost of production, and that's why we get a marginal cost which is equal to zero. And here, even if the firm, they know that they are interdependent on each other, but when they fix their output, when they fix their price, they are not taking into consideration the what will be the rivals plan on the basis of their revised plan. And that is the reason, if you remember in the last class, we discussed a situation when in the period they one fourth of the market remain unexplored, no one produced in that one fourth market, rest 3/4 market is got produced by both the firms A and B. So we'll continue our discussion on the Carnot model. We'll see that how the equilibrium solution can be achieved, or how the equilibrium can be achieved with the reaction and action pattern of the two firms. So in the last class, if you remember, we talked about a situation where the 3/4 of the market generally, so in that case, if you remember, then A, B together they were just producing 3/4 of the market, and 1/4 was not produced either by firm A or firm B, at least in the first period. Now what will happen in period 2? So this, in the first case, 3/4 was produced together by A and B, and 1/4 was not. Now how it will happen in period 2? Firm A assume that B just going to produce 1/4 of it, okay, and he will feel that 3/4 is his own market typically for a firm A. So if 3/4 is his own market, now generally he producing only half of it, so he'll produce half of 3/4 in the market, and that will come to 3/8 of total market. So A is going to produce 3/8 of total market. A assume that B just going to produce 1/4 of the market. So A will think that he just going to produce only 3/4, the total rest 3/4 is his own market, and he, since A produce only half of the total market, in this case the half of total market is half multiplied by 3/4, and that comes to 3/8 as the total market. Now we'll see how B is going to react to this. Okay, so B will consider that again, when it comes to B, what will be the assumption for B? The assumption for B is A will continue to produce 3/8 of the market. Means what is the market available for B? The remaining market, that is less by 3/8. So this is 1/3/8 is the market available to B. Now B will produce again half of this, because half of 1 minus 3/8, so this is 5/16. So A is going to produce 3/8, and B is going to produce 5/16. Now this action reaction pattern continues. Firm always assume that A always assume that B is going to produce half, and firm B is always going to assume that A is going to produce half. So they take out that half, and they feel that the rest of the market, whatever they could produce, and again it comes the half of the total market demand. So this action reaction pattern for firm A and B will continue. Now what is the outcome of this action reaction pattern of firm A and B? So it just goes on with the share, that is half of share, half of the total market except the share of A for B, and half of the total market except the share of B for A. So this action reaction will continue. So in this action reaction, generally share of A goes on decreasing and share of B goes on increasing, and this will lead to a situation where each firm supplies to an equal market, that is 1/3 of the total market. Okay, so this if you look at initially the share of A was higher than share of B, so this action reaction pattern will continue, and with the action reaction pattern finally each firm will reach to a situation where they are just producing 1/3 of the total market, and remaining this 1/3 of total market is produced by A, 1/3 of total market is produced by B, and remaining 1/3 is not getting produced either by A or by B. So, we will just take the graph to understand this, that how this reach to a situation where they just produce 1/3, 1/3, and leads to a case where rest 1/3 is remain on produce either by A and B. So, if you remember your reaction function, R1 dash is the reaction function of firm A, R2 dash is the reaction function of firm B. So, ideally this should be the situation where this is the amount of Q1, this is the amount of Q2. Q1 is produced by A, Q2 is produced by B. Now, how they reach to this Q1A to Q1B? It is not they start from here, rather they start from here. And what is this R1 dash here? At this point, the total market demand is, we can say OR2 dash is the total market demand. So, out of this, initially A will just produce this much, and from there actually this action reaction pattern happens. So, if this A is producing this, corresponding to this B will produce here, that in the reaction curve of B. R2 dash is the reaction curve function of B, R1 is the reaction curve function of A. So, if you look at, if initially A produce this much, now with reaction to this B will produce take a point corresponding to this in the reaction function of B, that is R2 dash. Corresponding to this, again A will react to this and choose a combination where in the reaction function of A. And if you remember what is reaction function gives the different quantity of Q1 and Q2, combination of Q1 and Q2 where profit is maximum. So, whether B chooses any combination in reaction function 2, A chooses any combination in reaction function 1, ideally they maximize the profit. So, to start with they will do this with A start with at this point, corresponding to this B choose a combination over here. Now, suppose this is combination 1, then this is combination 2, again chosen by A with respect to the reaction to a combination B by this 1, then corresponding to this again B will choose a combination here, and corresponding to this A will choose a combination here, then corresponding to this again B will choose a combination here, and here A will choose a combination here. This action reaction will continue till the time they are not reaching this point E, and after reaching the point E, they generally they reach the equilibrium solution where A produce Q1 unit of output and B produce Q2 unit of output. So, graphically how we reach the Carnot's equilibrium? We reach the Carnot's equilibrium through the reaction function approach. We take the reaction function 1, reaction function 2, and the reaction of both the firms get captured in their own reaction function, and finally eventually this reaction action pattern leads them to the equilibrium where they, this is generally stable, and after that at least in that time period again the reaction action pattern never continue. Then we will see the detailed description that how this 1/3 of this total market output comes to form one, we'll just take period wise that how this finally comes to 1/3 for form A and 1/3 for form B. So if you generally we'll just take a form of equation in order to understand this. So period 1, okay, we'll see what is form A, what is form B. So form A is half of total market, so this is half. Form B is half of half market, that is A share, that comes to 1/4. Then period 2, what will be for form A? Half of 1 minus 1/4, 1/4 is the B share, that comes to 3/8. Then what will be for form B? That is half of 1 minus 3/8, that comes to 5/16. Now what will be in period 3? Form A, that is half of 1 minus 5/16, this is B share, that comes to 11/32. So this is B share, 1 minus this, half of it going to be produced by form A. Form B, again half of 1 minus 11/32, this is share of A, so this comes to 21/64. Then we will talk about period 4, output of form A and form B. So this is nothing but just taking the share and making a half of it, but eventually we will see how they just produce 1/3 of the total output. So for period 4, this is again half of 1 minus 11/32. So that comes to 1 minus 21/64. So that comes to 43/128. And form B again half by 1 minus 43/128. So that comes to 85/256. Now this continue till the time period n. So we'll see how, what will be the value in period n, because n takes any number, so it's 1 to n. So in period n, what will be the share of form A and form B? Eventually it is form A half by 1 minus 1/3, so that comes to 1/3. And form B half of 1/1-3, that is coming to 1/3. Now what is A's equilibrium output? Now A's equilibrium output will be half minus 1/8/1/1-4. So that comes to half minus 1/8/3/4, which comes to 8/24 and 1/3. This is form B, form A equilibrium output. Similarly, we will find form B's equilibrium output. So, form B's equilibrium output 1/4 by 1 minus 1 4. So this is 1 by 4 divided by 3 by 4, which comes to 1 by 3. And for n number of farm, what will be the industry output and what will be the farm's output? Industry output will be n by n plus 1, or to again describe this, this is E is equal to 1 summation E 1 to n 1 by n plus 1. And what will be the individual firm's output? N 1 by n plus 1, this will be the individual firm's output both for A and B. So, ideally what we want to check over here, is that when the action reaction pattern happens, they assume the same behavior from other firms, and that is why they, if you find some of this which remain unutilized, that is not being produced either by firm A or firm B, and that is why they are just producing 1/3 of the total output of the market, and remaining 1/3 is not being produced either by A and B. Next, we will see, take an example to understand this Conrad model. We will just take a numerical to understand the Conrad's model, then we will move into the next model, that is Stackelberg model and Paul Swijek King demand curve model. So, P is equal to 100 minus 0.5 x, this is the demand function, this is cost function of firm A, which is it is a constant cost function. For firm B, it is the increasing cost function. We need to find out the profit maximizing level of output for both the firm A and B. Okay. And how we'll find out this? We generally take the profit maximizing rule, that is marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. So, what is this P? P, we can simplify this as 100 minus 0.5 x A plus x B, because this x is the total output, is the summation of output of A and B. And what will be the profit of A? What will the profit of firm A? That is total revenue minus total cost. And what is total revenue over here? So, total revenue minus total cost will give us the profit of A. So, this is P x A, this is the output, this is the price, minus 5 x A, this is the cost function of the firm A. So, what is P x A? That is 100 minus 0.5 that is x, so this is x A plus x B multiplied by x A minus 5 x A. So, this is cost function, this is P and this is x A. So, if you simplify this, then it comes to 100 x A minus 0.5 x A square plus, if you open the bracket, this is minus plus minus 0.5 x A x B minus 5 x A. Simplifying this again, this is 95 x A, because this 5 x A will get deducted from here, minus 0.5 x A square minus 0.5 x A and x B. Simplifying this, 95 minus x a minus 0.5 x b is equal to 0. So this is our marginal, that is our this profit. So this comes to marginal revenue equal to minus marginal cost has to be equal to 0. So this is 95. If you take the derivative, then this comes to 95, this comes to xa, this comes to 0.5 xb. Okay, so if you simplify this in term of xa, this comes as a 95 minus 0.5 xb. And what is this xa in term of xb? This is the reaction function of A. This is the reaction function of A. Similarly, we will find the reaction function of B. And if you remember, what is the reaction function of A? This combination gives the maximum level of profit to the firm A. Similarly, we will now find it for B. So, if you this for XB, we get it's 50 minus 0.25 XA. So, I am not just doing a detailed calculation for B. You need to follow the same formula to find out the what we did for A, the same formula to find out the reaction curve function for B. Basically, you need to find out the pi, then you need to maximize it. Pi is the difference between total revenue, total cost. You need to maximize this and then solve for the value in term of XB in term of XA. And that will give us the reaction curve function for B. Now, to find this value of xa and xb, we need to put the reaction curve of reaction curve function of b in a, and we can solve the value for xa. So in this case, we can find out xb is equal to 50 minus 0.25 xa. So now what we will do, we will put the value of xa in order to solve for xb. So this is equal to 50 minus 0.25 by 95 minus 0.5 xb. So that comes to 50 minus 23.75 plus 0.125 xb. So, solving for this, xb will be equal to 30, xa is equal to 80, and putting a value of xa and xb, that is 80 plus 30, that comes to 120. And putting the value of this, we will get the value of P, which is equal to 45. So, this is the output of the B, this is the output of A, and this is the profit maximizing level of output of A and B using the Carnot model or generally using the reaction curve approach. So, what we discuss in case of Carnot model, this is a typical situation where two firms engage with each other. They know the interdependence, but they are not considering the fact that they are interdependent to each other in order to decide the output plan. And that is the reason when they are revising their plan, they are not considering the what will be the rival's reaction to the revised plan, and ultimately they are reaching to a equilibrium which is stable, but in that case they are not exploring the output for the entire the market. And here we take the assumption that there is zero cost of production, and we also discuss in case of Carnot model that when we assume the zero cost and there is a linear demand curve, the output of the output of monopoly is half of competitive output, and duopoly output is the 2/3 of competitive output. So, to summarize this H per Carnot solution, equilibrium is stable and each firm will be maximizing profit by selling equal amount of output at the same price. So, price same, they are selling the equal amount of output, like one third of the total market. And equilibrium is reached when both the firm earns maximum profit and have no tendency to change their output.